This is Matt, and these are the Vintage Vinyl Albums for February 2020. The second album from Tokyo Blade, incidentally not from Tokyo, goes a decidedly more commercial route from their debut effort, as did a number of other bands from the new wave of British heavy metal scene, and this directional change was not without its consequences. One of the more glaring musical changes for this band was in the replacing of one vocalist for another. Their first singer, Alan Marsh, who had already recorded all of the tracks for this album, was replaced with the more commercially viable Vic Wright. As a result, the entire album was re-recorded, and it's Wright's vocals you hear on the final album version. Strangely, Marsh is still on the album, but is a backup vocalist, which is strange because you have both the replacement singer and the original singer on the record. Stranger still, Marsh isn't even credited for any vocals on the record. It's likely that the success of former scene mates Def Leppard might have influenced Tokyo Blade and other Nawabum bands to follow their lead and release more accessible albums. Given the time frame, that would make some sense and puts Tokyo Blade in league with Angel Witch and Tigers of Pantang, to name a couple decent examples. Best songs on the album are Unleash the Beast and the title track to Night of the Blade. For those wanting to hear the Alan Marsh version of the album, it was finally released in 1998 as Night of the Blade, The Night Before. If you've heard both, which one do you prefer? Let me know in the comments below. As for vinyl reissues, High Roller Records released a 2013 edition in red and white split vinyl, limited to 350 copies, as well as a black vinyl edition, also in limited release, but with only 150 copies pressed. Currently, Tokyo Blade is still active, and with all of its original members, including first vocalist Alan Marsh. In addition to playing live at metal festivals throughout the 2010s, they released a new album in 2018 entitled Unbroken, also spawning three music videos. The newest album is available on vinyl through 3msmusic.com. Often considered their seminal album, Darkness Descends carries over the energy of Dark Angel's debut record, but brings in better riffs, better songwriting, and better production, culminating in a true challenger to other thrash offerings of its time. Some of these improvements might have something to do with a bit of a lineup change. Former drummer Jack Schwartz went on to Holy Terror and was replaced by now legendary thrash drummer Gene Hoagland. In addition to Hoagland's masterful drum work, he's also a primary contributor to the songwriting and lyrics on this and future Dark Angel albums. This would also be the final album for vocalist Don Doty, who left the band to form a family, and was later replaced by the better-known Dark Angel singer Ron Reinhart. Notable tracks include Darkness Descends, Merciless Death, and at the top of the list, The Burning of Sodom. Suffer is rebellion inside the city gates. The worshiping the only priest, a master of all hate. Flag of the inverted cross, menace their eye. Laughing at the holy cross, twirl the pressure tide. Speaking of this track, I interviewed Gene Hoagland back in the early 90s for college radio and asked him about this specific song. Here's what he had to say.
I kept bugging my singer at the time, Don Doty. You know, Don, what are the lyrics of this song? I mean, The Burning of Sodom, it's such a provocative title. What is it? What are the lyrics? And he'd always be like, well, you know. And he would never give me an answer. And finally, I just like cornered him one night and said, damn it, you tell me what the lyrics are. I want to know what they are. I'm fascinated by the title. And then he, you know, he's like, there are no lyrics. You know, there's the chorus. There's, you know, falling from the heavens, angel I decayed, that part. But there's no verse lyrics. You know, we had the vocal line. We were performing it live. And I started just howling. I thought that was hilarious. So that was the first song I wrote. You know, I came back another, you know, 3 days later. I had lyrics for everything. And that was kind of the song that started, that forced Gene to start writing the lyrics for Dark Angel, really.
The title track to this album has the distinction for being the first known thrash song to be inspired by Judge Dredd, the British comic book character, who later spawned a couple theatrical releases in the decades following. More specifically, the track references the Dark Judges from early issues of the comic. And yes, this was an entire year before Anthrax's I Am the Law. A lot of folks like to compare this album to Slayer's Rain and Blood, not because they're sound-alikes, which they aren't, but because in 1986, these really were the two most brutal and next-level thrash albums released then. If you have an opinion on that, let me know in the comments. And in case you haven't run into this, this is a bit of a joke accusation, of sorts, from Hoagland regarding some assumed familiarity between a certain part of the title track and a part of Metallica's One. It seems the drum sextuplets, compared with the guitar riff in the latter, have some commonality with a similar part in Darkness Descends. Again, it's likely a bit of a joke, but you might also hear what's either a ripoff or a coincidence. Check it out if interested. There have been quite a few reissues of this album throughout the decades, especially from such companies as Back on Black and High Roller Records, and in a number of vinyl colors. But the most recent are the 2019 Century Media releases in three vinyl variants: black, green, and yellow. And these editions also come with a gatefold cover. I feel that Darkness Descends got more of its recognition after the fact, and although better late than never, it was always a strong and brutal thrash record that did hold up against its competitors. Definitely recommended. The third studio album for what was sometimes, and perhaps unfairly, considered a Ritchie Blackmore solo project had its share of difficulties and drama, but would the record match their already landmark releases before it? More on that later. To put it mildly, this is a rather strange time for Rainbow. Bands such as Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath were both in a relative musical slump, while other acts like Judas Priest and Van Halen were well on the rise. Given that, it's not a stretch to hear an attempt to appeal to all audiences here. When it works, it really works. And when it doesn't as much, well, at least it's the classic Rainbow lineup. Well, sort of. A couple band member changes did happen on this record, especially for keyboards and bass. On the keys is David Stone for some tracks, Tony Carey for others. And on bass, Blackmore did some tracks, and Bob Daisley was brought in for the rest. Much of the commercial leanings here were coming from Blackmore, which formed a bit of a rift between him and vocalist Ronnie James Dio. So much so that this would be Ronnie's last album with Rainbow, as he went on to do a couple of classic albums with Black Sabbath, and then a hugely successful solo career. Favorites include the title track, Kill the King, and the strangely awesome Gates of Babylon. So I'm just gonna say it, this is the last great Rainbow album. And yeah, I know, someone's gonna hate me out there for saying it, but given the departure of Dio, and the latter acquisition of far less talented singers, as well as losing Dio as a co-writer, not to mention Blackmore's obsession with becoming a radio-friendly pop rock act, and the power and punch of this band fades as quickly as, well, a rainbow. Although plenty of reissues of this album exist, mostly on CD, and either official or unofficial, the most relevant vinyl repressing comes from Back to Black in 2015, which includes a gatefold cover and a download card for the tracks. Not to be confused with Back on Black, Back to Black was a vinyl reissue series started in 2008 by Universal Music Group to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the 33 and a third vinyl LP. Now, is Long Live Rock and Roll a better record than Rainbow's previous album? Well, it's a good record with some solid tracks, but perhaps I'd point you to Rising first, with Long Live Rock and Roll a close second. Ah, screw it. Just get both and rock the hell out. Since I talked about Carnivore last episode, let's talk about the other crossover band. With the release of their third album, hardcore punk legends D.R.I. shifted gears a bit and changed their sound to a genre that would actually adopt the very name of this record, and its influence can be heard in even modern thrash bands. Short for Dirty Rotten Imbeciles, D.R.I. started out as a thrashcore band, basically sped up hardcore with occasional blast beats. It often gets confused with the crossover genre, which is a fusion of thrash metal and hardcore. The first three albums from D.R.I., culminating with this album, are the perfect examples of both, admittedly overlapping, genres. Crossover was produced by none other than Bill Metoyer, whose metal production resume, despite his utter lack of a Wikipedia page, might I mention, is impressive, including notable albums from Slayer, Trouble, Sacred Reich, and Flotsam and Jetsam, to name a few. Check out some of those 80s releases from Roadrunner and Metal Blade, and you're likely to see his name in the credits. Standout Track is a draw between five-year plan and fun and games. If it's a race and fun and games, for the rules of our way to change, plan to make, we don't range, only one thing stays the same. You steal the obvious set, you don't hate, you've been tricked. Think it's all just begun, you and I are in the end, fun. Not only did the crossover apply to the sound of this record, it also applied to the fans. Formerly incompatible audiences would show up at concerts from D.R.I. and other punk-influenced thrash bands such as Slayer, Nuclear Assault, and SOD. This was the first time when punks and metalheads were seeing overlap in their record collections, as well as mutual attendance at club shows, something unheard of only a half decade before. When my skinhead buddies in 1986 started praising Rain and Blood, I knew change was coming. If you're wanting to get a good sense of D.R.I. in action, seek out the 1988 release of Live at the Ritz, an 18-track live show recorded during the crossover tour in June of 1987. Copies of this home video release are currently available on either DVD or on YouTube. The most recent vinyl reissues of Crossover were released by Beer City Records in 2010, 2013, and 2018 in a number of vinyl colors. Known as the Millennium Edition, all tracks have been remastered by the original producer, with the CD version containing live tracks from the aforementioned live show. Log on to beercity.com for ordering details. So D.R.I. might have slowed down the speed and lengthened the time of some of their songs, especially when compared to their first two albums, but their choice to incorporate metal really does work here. Future releases would steer more towards a cleaner sound, but Crossover will often be considered the most memorable album in the band's discography for thrash fans. Check it out! The power metal juggernaut, known as Manowar, began their conquest of the world with a marginally produced album, but with some epic tracks. And while much has been said about most of their discography, it's their second album that sometimes gets sadly overlooked. Into Glory Ride marks the band's exit from Liberty Records and onto the much more prominent label known as Megaforce. The members of Manowar apparently felt it was an auspicious occasion, and perhaps besting Kiss on this one, signed their record contract in their own blood, as covered in the August 1983 issue of Kerrang! Magazine. The album was produced by John Mathias, who would later produce records for Mass, Banshee, and The Great Cat. As for Manowar, the production of Into Glory Ride is an improvement on Battle Hymns, but it seems having the level of production deserving of their music really wouldn't come until Fighting the World, when they'd finally get signed to a major label. And for those of you looking for secret messages etched in the runout of this record, you'll be happy to find Death to False Metal on the A side and Into Glory Ride on the B side. Hard choices here for favorites, as much of the tracks run par with each other. But if I have to choose, it's Gloves of Metal and Secret of Steel. You were called by the gods, their powers to wield. God will, the secret of steel. Oh, oh, oh. A month after the release of Into Glory Ride is when Manowar put out their well-coveted single for the song Defender. Released by Music for Nations, this is the original version of the song, which didn't appear on Into Glory Ride, but the song would later resurface in a newly recorded version on the 1987 release of Fighting the World. The two versions are noticeably different, and if you have a preference for one over the other, let me know in the comments. If you're familiar with the album version of the song, then you might already know that famed actor Orson Welles did the narration for it. And he's also on the single version, though it's an entirely different take, recorded from a different session with Welles. As far as promotion for the record, there is a music video for the track Gloves of Metal, a video I actually never knew existed until the age of YouTube, when I shared it with equally amazed friends, who also never knew about it. Seems getting the word out about Manowar back then wasn't easy. So the big mystery of this album, and something my research didn't solve, is in the dedication. Who exactly is John Robert Curry? If you know, let us all know in the comments below. Although there hasn't been an official vinyl reissue of this album yet, there was the Imperial Edition in 2019 by Magic Circle Entertainment on CD and digital download, and with all new cover artwork. Perhaps one day, Manowar will see fit to put out this album on the format, as they already had with most of their classic output. While perhaps not appreciated in the same way as Hail to England or The Triumph of Steel, Enter Glory Ride still has plenty of metal goodness to offer that really shines in its slow-driving guitars and pummeling drums. And, you know, maybe Eric can sing a little too. Incidentally, my favorite Manowar album. The sophomore effort from New York thrash legends Anthrax was a big step up from their first album and would set in motion a clearer path to their signature sound. After the firing of original vocalist Neil Turbin for trying to control the band, and perhaps because of Turbin firing bassist Denny Loker, because Loker was taller than Turbin and he didn't like that on stage, Anthrax actually entertained the idea of remaining a four-piece and having guitarist Scott Ian and bassist Frank Bello take over vocal duties. The album itself was actually fully recorded, but without vocals, and was merely waiting for a singer to come in and contribute. Enter Joey Belladonna, whose vocal style wasn't exactly traditional thrash metal, but the band was impressed with his talents and were wanting someone different from other singers in the genre, so Belladonna was hired. Although Belladonna's official debut was on the Armed and Dangerous EP, which came out 8 months before the release of Spreading the Disease, the EP was an excellent teaser for the full album to come. I bought Armed and Dangerous when it was new, and was pretty optimistic about the then-coming LP. But some folks find Belladonna's more commercial vocals not to their liking. Let me know which way you come down on that in the comments. Recommended tracks include AIR, Madhouse, and my very favorite, Aftershock. Perhaps out there observation I've had regarding the track Medusa is that Joey Belladonna sounds like Mike Reno of Loverboy, but only in the verse parts. Which might not be too far off the mark, considering that Belladonna sang tunes from Foreigner and Journey in his audition for the band. If you don't believe me about the Loverboy thing, listen to the track next time and keep that in mind. You'll hear it. Oh, and if the track sounds a bit like the odd man out on this album, that might be because producer John Zazula wrote it. Later editions credit the band as well, but it's likely Zazula was the chief songwriter. A good track, but it doesn't fit well with the other songs. In promotion for the record, the band were also in their first official music video for the track Madhouse. It's a fairly primitive effort, but it was the first glance of Anthrax a lot of us got back then. Sadly, MTV wouldn't play it because they felt it made fun of mental patients, which it probably does. Of course, some of you who watch this show might be wondering if Spreading the Disease actually charted, and the answer is yes. The album reached number 113 on the Billboard 200 chart in March of 1986. The most recent reissues of Spreading the Disease on vinyl include the 2010 release from Back on Black in either yellow or white vinyl, 1,000 copies each, as well as the 2014 European release from Island Records and UMG, also on white vinyl. Spreading the Disease was not only a great album on its own, but it was also the precursor for what was to come on the next record, the much-lauded Among the Living. Spreading the Disease is a thrash classic for some very good reasons. Give it a spin. If you're a fan of the Vinyl Reacquisition Project, you'll definitely want to pick up an official VRP t-shirt. Log on to the website listed below for ordering details and get yours today. So definitely pick up the t-shirt. You'll look great in it. And on that note, just want to let you know, if you haven't done before, subscribe to this channel, let your friends know about it, tell them to subscribe too, why not? Also like and share the videos, you know how to support this network, it's easy, you push buttons, you push more buttons, it's all buttons, it's great, do it. And if you want to contribute further, consider becoming a patron of the Accusation Network. It's super easy. You go to patreon.com/theaccusationnetwork. You check out all the reward tiers in the descriptions there and see how you can contribute. See what you can put in. It's a great way to support this network. It's a great way to support me and future shows. I love it. I appreciate it. So at least check out the info. Do it. Why not? And of course, see you next month.